is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
One day, when the glory comes, it will be ours, it will be ours. Oh, one day, when the war is won, we will be sure, we will be sure. Oh, glory,
glory, glory,
oh,
glory, glory.
Hands to the heavens, no man, no weapon formed against, yes, glory is destined. Everyday women and men become legends. Sins that go against our skin become blessings. The movement is a rhythm to us. Freedom is like religion to us. Justice is juxtaposition in us. Justice for all just ain't specific enough. One son died, his spirit is revisited us. True and living, living in us. Resistance is us. That's why Rosa sat on the bus. That's why we walk through Ferguson with our hands up. When it go down, we woman and man up. They say stay down, and we stand up. Shots, we on the ground. The camera panned up. King pointed to the mountaintop, and we ran up.
One day.
Good morning. Welcome to Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. You know my voice already. It's Leyvon Miller. Thank you so much for joining me. Thank you so much for letting me join you. I don't know what it is that you do at 11 o'clock, but whatever it is that you do, I am happy that you're doing that, do, and that you decided to do that, do with me. It's a Friday. Bam. The people, them tired awaken. Ba-dum, ba-dum. All right. So I see we've been doing all sorts of things around here. We're giving out pictures of Sir Randall Fox as a gift from the Prime Minister to whatever this association of people are. And instantly, my antennas go up, right? Instantly, I get nervous about this kind of stuff because I know that in the Bahamas, it is quite okay to be a copycat nation. But everywhere else in the world, whether it's, you know, where it's a real country, there are things like copyright infringement laws and who has the authority to issue publications, etc., etc., etc. Now, the wind told me that there were a number of other trinkets that should have been handed off as gifts during the Prime Minister's tour, notwithstanding that. The only one that I see in a picture anywhere is the one of him and the picture of Sir Randall Fox and Martin Luther King. And instantly I get nervous again, like I said, because I realize that it is a replica of the photo and not even an enlargement of the actual photo. So, yes, I am very happy to see the celebrity artist Jamal Ruhl getting himself some international airplay again with a masterful sketch of the photo of Sir Randall Fox and Martin Luther King. I believe that that would have been in Bimini, of course, right ahead of I Had a Dream speech, which is said to have been written in Bimini. And you know that also Sir Randall Fox penned the book. And he talks in his book about the letter that Martin Luther King had sent him. And then I think about how the picture or the replica by Jamal Ruhl is such a missed opportunity, right? Like, I would imagine if you're going to... See, here's why I can't ever go and link up with Pookie them, right? Because whenever I break the law, I like to break all the law one time. That's just how I like to do it. Whenever I break the law, I like to break all the law one time. And that is why I went and became a justice of the peace, you know, because I said to myself, if I wasn't going to break the law with impunity, then I was certainly going to uphold Her Majesty's good peace, law and order without fear or favor, prejudice or ill will. And that is what I've decided to do. So that's why I am at Pookie Dam. But if by chance I was going to break the law, I was going to just do it wholesale. First of all, I was going to get Jamal to draw this thing without no kind of approval letter from no one, nowhere in the world. And I was going to put it in a much bigger frame. That's first off. Secondly, I would have mint the book of Sir Randall Fox in the bottom left corner, mint an actual replica of the letter that was sent to him by Martin Luther King, right? And then just to make sure it's official, I was going to get a brass coat of arms and rest it right in the corner. Or even the, you know, we used to have the island flags. You remember the island flags? We used to have every island had a flag. I would put a replica of the Bimini flag in the corner. You see, because when they put it in the Smithsonian or the wherever this picture will end up, right? There needs to be a story behind its origin. I don't just need another picture of Martin Luther King, sitting on with some random dude, because that's what it's going to be to every American that sees it, out of looking at a lampstand, looking over one piece of paper. What does this picture mean to anybody that's not the daughter or son of Randall Fox, or not the daughter or son of Martin Luther King? Now, I also understand, the wind told me this, that it was a very tight invitation list. Notwithstanding that, no matter how tight the invitation list is, I feel like if you send another picture of the Turin daddy, the least you could do is ask one of the Turin to come. When you're breaking the rules, break all. So I was going to get there with something that I couldn't even put on a Bahamas Air flight, because it was going to be an oversized package, right? Wherever they mount this, they was going to need to give me a whole wall, because this was going to be my one opportunity to show the nexus between the Martin Luther King and all of his Martin Luther Kingites, right? And the Bahamas, and how intrinsically woven they are together. And how you had to come to Bimini as a place of solace in order to be able to intertwine with the spirit of Martin Luther King. I don't know why I keep calling him Malcolm X. Martin Luther King. That is what we should have sold. Right now, we have a half-baked presentation. The new prime minister, not even 6 weeks in his term in office yet, has presented to the public something that could very well find itself in copyright infringement issues on an international level. Because I've called two of the best photographers in this country, and they can't tell me who owns the picture. I do know that there is a little convenience store in Bimini that has that exact picture hanging up. Whether they are the owners of it, I don't know. I know that you could find it online. If you Google search Martin Luther King in the Bahamas, one of the first pictures that will come up is the one of him and Randall Fox. The question becomes, the picture did not take itself. Someone had to take the picture. Who, in fact, was that? And we've been down this road before with the Progressive Liberal Party. Or was it the Free National Movement? No, it was the Free National Movement. When we decided to put a picture of Sir Lyndon Penland, Ingram did that. When we decided to put the picture of Sir Lyndon Penland on the dollar bill, we ran into this problem before. That you can't just take, we don't care who face it is, someone, the man didn't take the picture himself, right? Someone took the picture. And if someone, in fact, took the picture, then that person has rights to that picture. And I don't know if Jamahal Rule could just go and draw a picture of my picture and y'all go give it away as a gift. And so I want to talk about that a little bit. I want to talk about the international ramifications that may come as a consequence of this decision. And then I want to talk about the absolute missed opportunity. Because if you go break the law, man, not for my sake, but for Christ's sake, break the whole law. You know, like how y'all break the law to put this ridiculously stupid brown color on the $100 bill just so y'all could put 80 Hanna there. Y'all must be trying to match his skin tone. I don't know what this god-awful color is. All right? And y'all missed that entire opportunity, right? Because y'all wanted to break the law and put the living man on the money, right? Thank God he dead in time for y'all to don't have to break the law, right? Because other than that, y'all was just going to break it. So y'all going to break the law, right? Put this absolute atrocity of a color on this money. And now the blue marlin even ain't quite blue no more. He like a bluish hue gray. I ain't really sure what that is. I don't know what we call this piece of money anymore. Colloquially, that is. Because everybody wanted a marlin. I don't know what this thing here is. And to think that a grunt and a jellyfish could make it on the money, but no one, and with all of the intelligentsia sitting in the room, that is the Central Bank of the Bahamas, no one thought to themselves that if we were going to break the law to put 80 on the front, man, we should put the flamingo on the back, because that was the single most isolated incident in his political career, and we would be able to justify that because we break the law big time. You don't break half the law. That don't make sense. So when you're always going to infringe on copyright laws to replicate a photo that no one could tell me who owned it, and I'm very well advised that y'all don't know who owned it either, so don't play with me, right? When y'all decided y'all was going to do this, the least we could have got out of this is some marketable value. The least the Bahamas could have got out of this was some, oh my God, did you read the letter that Martin Luther King wrote to Sir Randall Fox and how he encouraged him to steady the fight? And do you realize that this was right before the assassination? And do you realize that this was right in the middle of equality for blacks? And do you realize that he saw Bimini as his place to come and hear from God? And so now you got to tie that together in a Ministry of Tourism package? And we break in the law, you know, to completely miss opportunities. But you know what they'll say? They'll say I'm anti-PLP and that nothing the PLP do is correct. And no matter if the PLP found a way to turn water into wine, I'd still complain. I probably would. But if they turned water into beer, I probably would a little less, right? But we just cannot. You cannot run countries like this, man. Like, you have smart people in the room, but even those smart people need advisors to advise them. I often say, all of us as human beings are imperfect in our own right. However, if you are interested in public life, you need to hire an imperfect human to help you be perfect. And that's what has to happen. You need someone in the room to say, Chief, anybody find out who owned the picture? You can't just go and draw up a bunch of pictures to give away internationally, man. Come on. And let me pick up a lawsuit for this. You know what y'all gonna do? Y'all gonna settle out of court, and some dude who probably can't even remember what day this was, he's gonna become a millionaire because y'all don't care enough to do the due diligence. Anyway, Cecil Nuri is in studio with me. I brought him to kind of help me dissect this because maybe I miss things. I'm not sure. So Cecil Nuri, good morning. How are you, buddy?
It's always good to be on your show, Leyvon. And I remember we were discussing this on social media earlier, and you brought up the issue on what is the significance of this picture, because there's no narrative attached. And I put the question to you, what gives the picture value? Mm-hmm. If we're going to donate this, surely it's supposed to be valuable. Mm-hmm. And is it valuable because Jamal Rowe painted it? That's the value of it. Is it valuable because it shows a connection to the Bahamas with Martin Luther King? And if that's the case, wouldn't the original picture have more value than a painted version? Mm-hmm. Is it valuable because of the letter that you mentioned earlier that mm-hmm. is attached to the picture? Or is the value comes about that Martin Luther King spent some time in the Bahamas? Mm-hmm. And I put it to you that picture itself donated to the Martin Luther King Foundation has no value. Mm. It has no value because there's no narrative attached to it. Mm-hmm. And this is where our dialogue came on, and I guess why you invited me on your show today,
right,
to discuss whether we, in our good intent, give something that has no value mm-hmm. to the foundation, and the value was left home in the Bahamas. Mm-hmm. And that's what we're going to be discussing today. Because where is the value?
Literally, the picture now donated to the association that it was, literally the only thing you could do with that picture is put it in a room with a bunch of other things you can't determine what they are for. You know what I mean? It's like, I don't know. Like, you have that one auntie that keep bringing you the little cake thing that you never did eat.
Yeah. Fruit cake every Christmas.
Right. And so now you got one bunch of little can of fruitcake in your room that been there minting for the last 10 years because no one eats these. Mm-hmm. That's basically what that picture amounted to, in my estimation. There's anyone that doesn't know who Jamal Rowe is can't have the value there. Mm-hmm. Anyone that doesn't know where the picture was taken can't have a value of it there. Mm-hmm. Anyone that doesn't know the Bahamas benefits nothing from it because all these Americans, there are 360-odd million Americans, right? Mm-hmm. And which one of them know who Randall Fox is?
No.
By point precisely. So now you got Martin Luther King sitting down in a photo with some random, according to Americans.
Remember, it's not a photo, it's a picture, a drawing. And so you can put anyone, random person.
Some random dude, right?
Yes.
And so now You can't even say, unless you intimately know that it's a Bahamian, or intimately know, unless a Bahamian says, ah, that's a... The average Bahamian doesn't know what Randall Fox looks like.
Hmm.
There are very few pictures of him anywhere. There are very few, but there are no statues of him anywhere. So the question then becomes, how did we determine this? Like, how did we determine that this was the perfect gift to go present to the same function where the President of the United States of America would be? What were we thinking?
But I'm just happy that we are again invited to international...
What did stop us from getting invited the last time?
I don't know. I know that after Perry Christie left, we just stopped going to places. We're not going to any nice places, you know? I know when Mr. Christie was there,
yeah,
you saw some nice photos of him at the Trumpet Awards, yeah, and wherever it is.
Yeah.
And all that stopped. And
like
this,
the
Minnesota
administration
weeks,
had Oprah Winfrey on a cruise ship. They had to catch a skiff to it, too. I couldn't understand that.
But, you know, 6 weeks in,
yeah,
we see our current prime minister being invited to such pageantry again. Mm-hmm. So it's good. It's good. And I think it's good for the Bahamas to be included in such invitations,
mm-hmm,
right? And I felt that with the prime minister being invited, right, he wanted to give something of value,
mm-hmm,
to the foundation. My thing is, what was given, I'm not sure, and I'm not necessarily sure that it has value.
Mm-hmm.
And the value of the painting comes with the narrative and the story.
Mm-hmm.
And the story from the picture we saw was not included.
Precisely. Right? Because here you have in the picture two juggernauts in the fight for freedom and equality for black,
yes,
people. Of course, Martin Luther King from a completely different level. Martin Luther King was trying to get, you know, civil rights, etc.
But don't forget, we had a number of civil rights.
Labor right and, you know, labor benefits for people, etc. He was the leader of the labor movement,
yes, movement
at the time. Of course, Martin Luther King was over there trying to stop black people from being whipped with, you know, sprayed with water and bitten with dogs and that kind of stuff at the, mm-hmm, time, right? It was the civil rights movement, civil rights era. I think this picture is 66 because I think he was assassinated in 67, right? And, I mean, when you consider that these two men fundamentally are the bedrock of black equality on this side of the world,
mm-hmm,
right? You now take this picture. You could literally type in a Google search the letter that Martin Luther King wrote to Randall Fox, and guess what? It pops up. So you didn't have to go. Just like how you replicated,
mm-hmm,
this picture that you can't find the owner of, you could have replicated the letter, and at least we would have been able to tie it to the Bahamas.
Yes.
And then you you either put a bronze of the Bahamian coat of arms, which I think would have no value, or you put the flag of Bimini because it says Bimini,
mm-hmm,
and at least now people know, well, Bimini and this picture and this letter are all tied together, mm-hmm, and now we could begin to piece the story together because Martin Luther King was Baptist. Baptists make up one of the largest denominations on the planet.
Mm-hmm.
Do you imagine how many black African-American Baptist preachers,
mm-hmm,
use Martin Luther King as the...
their benchmark.
Right. Mm-hmm. And so now when they look for spirituality and a place to go, guess where they want to go?
Bimini.
Down, yes. And we frittered this opportunity away. It literally pissed it against the wall. That is what we did. And I don't know who's advising them on these things. I don't know who thought that it was reasonably intelligent to do this. Because it wasn't.
And I hear you. And I wanted, before I even mention what I want to say now, I wanted to say that a number of civil rights activists from the United States came to the Bahamas. They,
mm-hmm,
came to the Bahamas to get inspired. You see, even in terms of Sir Lyndon and his movement, right, which is basically the same time as Randall Fox,
right?
We see celebrities coming down and helping with Sidney Poitier and whatever it is.
Mm-hmm.
So that narrative, our connection to the United States is a big thing, right? And I think that story needs to be told, and,
mm-hmm,
that story and that opportunity was lost in telling that story,
mm-hmm,
that the Bahamas can become a mecca for the new age civil rights movement, that persons come down to have the tranquility of the Bahamas to evoke the spirit of Martin Luther King.
Mm-hmm.
And like you said, it was missed out. But I want to mention this, right? I know you mentioned earlier that the invitation was limited.
Yeah, yeah. The wind told me that.
The wind told you that.
Yeah, I heard that.
You know, I mean, if it is, whatever it is.
Mm-hmm.
But I remember some weeks, months ago when a political party used a picture of Sir Lyndon Pendant.
Mm-hmm.
And the Sir Lyndon Pendant Foundation got enraged, incensed, emotional. Mm-hmm. Said, how dare do you use a picture of our father
mm-hmm.
that belongs to the foundation for your personal gain and benefit without contacting us?
Mm-hmm.
There's a big hullabaloo and people are saying, but does Sir Lyndon... owned by the foundation, or is it owned, his image owned by the people of the Bahamas? Mm-hmm. It can be used anyway.
Mm-hmm.
The Randall Fox also has a foundation,
right,
where the image of him is belonged to his family, his family guards his legacy jealously, right? And I'm saying, I wonder if the family was approached, contacted, and say, by the way, be using the image of your loved one.
Mm-hmm.
To represent the Bahamas through this gift, right? And I wonder if they were even included, invited to, hey, we're going along to meet these bigwigs in the United States. And the story of your father is so instrumental, so important.
But they ain't carry no stories yet.
But the idea that they had the picture, right, they know that it was significant enough to carry the picture.
Right.
That one would assume that it would be significant enough to carry a family member, say, hey, tell your story. Let these people know that in the Bahamas, there was a contemporary of Martin Luther King who helped inspire him,
mm-hmm.
right? Tell a story about their interaction. And that didn't seemingly happen. Mm-hmm. Like I said, I don't know if there any invitation was suggested. But what I know for sure, that none of them was there.
Right.
None of them,
right.
No folks was there.
As a matter of fact, that picture. When the wind blew in the next direction, the wind told me that the folks turned find out but the picture, when the world find out but the picture, they didn't even know.
They didn't know.
Yeah, the wind tell me that.
The wind tell you that.
So yeah. If any one of the Fox children hear this and wish to either confirm or deny whether or not my sources are seated well enough, sure. I mean, we could just be kvetching, CA, right?
And we could be nitpicking, and I don't want to be a nitpicker.
But even if the photographer is dead and there will be no consequences at that level, because the picture is obviously about 50 years old.
Definitely 51, 52 years old.
Right. So the person that took it could be dead, right? That's very possible. And there may not be consequences on that level. My whole deal is, though, if you're going to teether with infringements in that way, then, man, let's get something out of the deal. All right? Fate to Move Mountain. You put that in the left-hand corner. That's
the book?
Fox book. No, okay. You put it in the picture so everybody could see the front page and say, this is wonderful. What is this? That's the book that was written by Sir Randall Fox that accounts of his time with Martin Luther King. I don't care how much page in there. Mm-hmm. Call Martin Luther King name. All I know is every black Baptist American preacher coming on a plane to the Bahamas now needs a copy of Fate to Move the Mountain, right? Let's think about what that does for the Fox family, because God knows we really ain't ever do nothing for them special, mm-hmm. okay? Then you put the picture, bang, that in the middle, that's the centerpiece. Then beneath that, you put, you know, and this is how you tie it back to us,
mm-hmm.
so that at least we could translate this into dollar value.
Mm-hmm.
Completely lost.
So you're saying there's no dollar value in what you saw at all?
I promise you that the shore is east, is in the opposite direction from west. 10 years from now, when they go to look for that picture, it's going to be in the darkest little back room somewhere in the back of a building that no one goes into and may possibly be leaking water through the ceiling. It doesn't have value. It's a trinket. That's what it is at this point. It's a trinket. I mean, luckily, Jamal possibly got
I'm happy for him.
10 seconds of fame on the front page.
No, right? I'm just saying that he got paid to do it.
He probably got paid to do it, all right? But I don't know. Anyway, people are calling the phone line, CA. Let's see what they got to say. 323-6232-325-4316. 325-4259. What do you got going on there, CA? You can give me a text at 422-4796. Cecil Nuri is in studio with me. You know, he's my social media commentator and blogger. And, he kind of always has his finger on the pulse of what's going on around the place. And instantly, when I made a notation about it yesterday in social media, Cecil Nuri was there. And so we decided to talk about it today because I'm offended. Y'all offend me. And so since I offended, I want to see how much of y'all offended. All right, let's take some calls. Good morning, caller. You're on.
Hey, morning, Leyvon. How you doing?
I'm good.
And Cecil Nuri, I'm glad to do y'all on this morning because I need some advice. But listen,
mm-hmm.
if you have a problem spending $80 on the money, but I bet you on it, you could see it to me, you know.
Not with the picture. No. And man, I want some people to donate me a couple, right? I think I think the color is an atrocity. That's one. The second thing, though, is, man, we missed that beautiful opportunity to say, you know something, we saw it so important to galvanize history in this way. But
well, I don't want to talk about that too long.
I know.
Anybody who has a problem with that, send it to me tomorrow.
Go ahead.
But listen, I would like to commend a lady at BAF Financial, the benefits department. Her name is Ms. Nixon. Mm-hmm. I have never seen customer service like that in a very long time. I think her boss is Mr. Oman Voss.
Mm-hmm.
I think you might know Oman.
Oh, I know Oman very well.
She went over the top helpful the other day, even after work. And I would really like to commend her. We need more people in business services like Ms. Nixon at the AAF.
Okay.
Second of all, I need you and Nuri advice.
Okay.
I am a recovering COVID patient at Doctors West, right? We are out there. Come from PMH out there. Now, we have a problem that they say the new policy is we need to have 2 negative COVID tests in order to return to our normal place of treatment.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I don't know where over the world you need 2 negative tests within a 10-day span of each other in order to go back to work. I thought it was 1 negative test. Y'all could help me if y'all hear anything with that, about that.
You need 2 negative tests to go back to work?
I call it work. For treatment, like I treat at PMH, but I'm out Doctors West recovering COVID.
Mm-hmm.
6 weeks now, but they telling the patients we need 2, 1 negative, and then 10 days later, you need another negative in order to go back. Is that requirement for anywhere else?
Not that I've heard. I mean, I know the travel requirement is that you need a PCR to travel, and then I think 5 days later.
And that's 1 negative, right?
Yeah, that's 1 negative, and then 5 days later, you need a second antigen test as a follow-up. Are they requiring double PCRs for you to...
Double PCR negative test.
I've not heard about that. That's new. I've never heard that.
Yeah, something got to be wrong with that. You understand?
And you're supposed to pay for both.
But no, they do the testing, but 10 days apart, if I take one today, Leyvon, and I take that negative, and 10 days come up again, and then I take another one, I could be positive because all of us in the same environment, a little room down there, with 1 air condition, no window, several persons in the dialysis, 2 people coming in and out, and we can't seem to get a negative test. No way. Because some are down there for 6 weeks, 2 months, 3 months, you know, and can't get a negative test to come back.
Mm.
And when the negative test come back, they tell you you need 2.
I don't know. I have to look into that. I've not heard that. This is the first time I've ever heard that.
Yeah, so. Something got to be wrong with that, man.
Sure, let me look
into that. You understand? I mean, then ain't only that. My third concern down there is the distance. Someone like me who legally blind and don't drive no more, I tell them my concern is that I don't have ready transportation. I own invalidity benefit, right? They tell me, well, get down there as best you could. Now, for a life-saving treatment like that, you would expect that for people who have a challenge with ride, they would try to assist you, right? In some form. Hey, Daddy, get down there the best way you could. You understand me? Now, my little pension, what to put my little grocery in my house and thing at an invalidity benefit, I got to take that to pay a hacker $25 a day, 3 times a week, to get down there, and now I owe the money. My next paycheck ain't until November the 23rd. So how am I supposed to get down there for my life-saving treatment? It ain't like you're going under to get bandage up or change your dressing or something like that. The dialysis treatment is life-saving for us.
Right.
And these people telling us, can't do the best way you could.
I don't know what to say. Let me try to look into it and see if I could get some answers for you between now and, well, today is Friday. So, I don't know. And you say you go back to dialysis on every 3 days, so that means you go again on Monday.
Yeah, you got
to
go 3 times a week. That's roughly for me. That for me, that's $35 a trip round trip. The hacker drop you there, pick you back up.
So you're spending about $100
a week. That's all my little pension money going right there.
Yeah.
Like something can't be right with that because they didn't. The stakeholders in this are the patients, but they just treat the patients like we third and second class citizen in this tripartite agreement: the doctor, the nurse, and the patient. They made a decision without consulting the patient, you understand me, as to how we can get down there. That's like then go for treatment in Andres, be temporary, do that. Be able to go Andres for treatment, but get Andres the best way y'all could. Some of y'all, because some people could get there. Mm-hmm. But people, for instance, like myself, have a challenge with a ride.
And you have to always make laws like to believe among you. I get that. So, listen, here's what I do know. I do know that they do listen to this show. I know because they like to cuss me out when they see me. So let's hope that one of the people that like to listen are listening and that they've pointed it out to Dr. Michael Darvill that we need to revisit that policy. And I'm going to look into it and see what it is that I could find out in the meantime. All right.
Yeah, because something can't be. I ain't a Nui. What happened? Nui normally got answer for something. Nui, what happened, buddy?
I'm listening. And
no, this is a perplexing problem.
I don't know what to say.
Yeah. Okay, then, Leyvon. And like I say, Miss Nixon, kudos to Miss Nixon. Yeah.
All right. Appreciate it.
Okay, thank you.
All right, Miss Nixon and Omen Forbes, you say. I know Omen. I'll probably see him again sometime today. Let's take another one. Come on, Carly, you're on.
Hey, how you doing?
Good.
First round caller.
Thank you.
My question is this a comedy show or is it like a real life commentary show? Because I mean, the commentary over the art pieces that was donated to the Martin Luther King Foundation thing, I mean, it seems like drivel. Like, nothing about it makes sense.
Which part was drivel?
I was a Bohemian artist, created the art piece. Mm-hmm. I was donated to the foundation.
Correct.
I mean, there is value there.
Yes.
Where's the conversation?
No. Let me help you with it.
The storyline is also valuable.
No, let me help you with it. You asked for my interpretation. Let me give it to you. My interpretation is this. One, no one even knows who the originator of the photo is. One.
Why does it matter?
Because the office of the prime minister took this trinket to donate to a foundation.
You can't call it a trinket. It's a painting by an artist, a Bohemian artist, a world-class Bohemian artist.
No, and
how does it become a trinket in your mind?
Because first of all, it probably infringes on copyright law.
What's copyright? And how are you saying possibly? What are you saying?
Are
you saying it infringes on anything?
You have to let me answer you. You can't continuously ask questions and not let me answer you.
Go ahead.
First of all, no one took the time, and I'm very well advised on this, no one found out where the picture originated from. They sketched a picture without getting any clearance to do so. That could possibly land us in copyright infringement issues. Then we gave that thing to the Prime Minister of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas for him to go and give as a gift. Guess who he gave that gift on behalf of? The people of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. I argue, if you were going to break the law in that way, then you might as well have done it in a way that actually translated into some sort of benefit for the Bahamas, which would be mounting a copy of the book that is Randall Fox's, mounting a copy of the letter that was Martin Luther King's to Randall Fox, and possibly attaching some sort of identification piece that lets us know where this picture actually happens. As it stands right now, there is a picture.
The party of the Bahamas, a bunch of smart people.
Yes.
And I mean, I know you think you're the smartest person, but you believe that they didn't give.
No, I actually am beginning to think that you are the smartest person now because you're not listening to me. And I'm not going to
think that they provided context of the image that was given?
And I'm saying to you, when they provide that context to the people sitting there in the room, great. What happens 10 years from now when there's 1,000 different people sitting in the room staring at a picture that only has Jamal Rowland?
That's what art curation is. Somebody who curates any exhibit that will include that will include the context. That's how it works.
We disagree. All right, so we could disagree. I think I know that voice. Whenever you get airtime, you could disagree with me on your airtime, and that's fine. But I completely disagree. And I think the fact that you cannot see that there ought to have been more to the... First of all, we should have gotten the authorization. Secondly, we should have had the decency to actually tell the family. I think I know that voice very well. No, that is a comedy show. I actually do commentary here. All right? And the thing that I want to point out is the fact that we continue as a country. We did it with 80 Hannahs on the $100 bill. We're doing it here. As a country, we miss massive opportunities when literally, if we put just a little more due diligence, these could be very meaningful things. Today, as it stands, that picture amounts to about as much as a green bow on a Christmas gift, and it's probably going to be tossed in a back room somewhere, never to be seen again. That is my bet on it, all right? And that's how I feel about it. And we're going to talk about it on the next Saturday break. 323-623-2323. If this is a comedy show, do I look like I do comedy to you? This is Leyvon Miller be talking about. Whenever I want to do comedy, I just go in water and hold. I'll be back after this.
J.S. Johnson Insurance agents are the best. Reliable service, we've been on the scene, protecting since 1919. J.S. Johnson Insurance has the best. Always, you're always covering me. J.S. Johnson Insurance, peace of mind.
Hey, did you find the show interesting? Do you want to be a part of the conversation? Well, sponsor Unleashed today. Call 302-2304 or 302-2375 to see which package is right for you. Join Leyvon Miller as he ignites the passion of the next generation by bridging the gap with engaging conversations and innovative ideas. Take action and sponsor Unleashed today at 302-2304 or 302-2375 and be unleashed.
The new Guardian Radio app is here. Listen live to all our Guardian Radio shows and live video stream select programs in our studio. Get information about Guardian Radio shows and our hosts. Send messages, including text, email, and even call. All from our amazing new Guardian Radio app. Download it free today in your App Store for your Apple device or Play Store for your Android device. The all-new and improved Guardian Radio app.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Welcome back. Thank you so much for staying with me, all of you that have stayed. Apparently, I rub an artist on their back the wrong way this morning. You know, AK Raiders kind of do that. Yeah. And the best way to have my story told is for me to tell it myself. You know, because they say the only reason the lion never wins the hunt is because the lion doesn't write the book. If the lion ever got an opportunity to tell the story about the hunter, this is how it would go. Boy, they sent a whole busload of hunters for me one time. I eat every single one of them. And then they send one bus full of hunters come and look to look for that bus full of hunters. And I eat them too. Man, and one day I was there tired under the tree. I don't even know where this boy come from. Bam, shoot me with a gun. And now he's the greatest hunter that ever lived. Notwithstanding the fact I didn't kill two busload of hunters. I don't even know what kind of hunters they supposed to be. That would have been the story of the lion. So what we now plan to do is take a picture, put Jamal Roll name on it, put it in some museum somewhere, association, organization, I don't really care where it is, and let a curator go and tell me how it's foolishness. Absolute foolishness. Because we didn't need the office of the prime minister to go do that. Yeah, y'all could have sent any one of those people from up by the National Art Gallery or something to go do that. Hmm. If you're talking about sending the instruments of this state, I expect a certain level. And what I saw wasn't it. Full stop.
And again, I speak about value. And let's compare. Put the picture itself, the actual picture, juxtaposed to the painting or the interpretation. Mm-hmm. Which one has the value?
The
picture, right? Because the picture documents a point in time, right. an actual happening, right? And whereas the painting, the art form is an interpretation. Mm-hmm. Instead of having a Randall Fox folks there with Martin Luther King, we could have put a drawer of Lyndon.
Randall Fox.
Fox. I keep on pronouncing. Mm-hmm. Forgive me for the family. I could have put a Lyndon there. Right? Because it's just a drawing.
You could put anyone there.
I could put my face there, like you said. And you see that where is the value?
Yeah.
The value comes in that the picture took a specific point in time, mm-hmm. a happenstance, mm-hmm. right? And that's where
let me ask you this question. Jamal Roll also drew a portrait. I think it was him that drew the portrait of Lyndon Penland, Martin Luther King, Barack Obama. You remember that was popular around here for a little bit, right?
Yes, yes.
Well, why are we in send that one?
You think they would have value with that?
Because that would have no value,
okay.
right? And so The point I'm making is if we flash up the whole office of the prime minister, see, you have to understand what it takes to move a nation's leader, you know. Mm-hmm. Like this scene, children church we play in. Yes. We're talking about the office of the prime minister here. And if we were going to put all of that effort, and I get it, the prime minister wants to be seen in places.
No, that's great.
Yeah.
That's great.
Because he wants the question to be asked, well, who is that? Who are they? Where are they from? That's the prime minister of the Bahamas. Really? Yeah, man, have him come over here. Yes. I didn't know he was that little. You understand? And so we get into these little conversations. Don't act like these people aren't real human beings. Yes. They have superficial conversations. Mm-hmm. Hey, how are you? You're the prime minister of the Bahamas? Yes. Oh, good to meet you, man. I actually went to one or two of the islands in the Bahamas. Well, yes. Where did you go? Mm-hmm. You know, rich people from America like to always tell you, I went to the Keys. I went to the Exuma Keys.
I went to Bimini.
Oh, you went to Bimini. Well, that's so interesting because I'm actually here to bring this, not that little thing they carried. Mm-hmm. Six guards would probably have to bring the thing in that I was going to carry if I were prime minister. And they were literally going to have to give me a whole wall because this thing I bring is possibly one of the greatest crowning moments in Martin Luther King's last couple years on the planet as a human being. You cannot just make it as frivolous as that. It's as simple as that. I don't know what's there to not be understood.
But so, and again, I'm going to speak on value, right? And I'm going to change the script and say value to the Bahamas now instead of value to the painting itself. Mm-hmm. Value to the Bahamas, right? There are two significant things that happened to the Bahamas via Martin Luther King. One, his relationship with Randall Fox, if I'm trying to make sure I pronounce it, right? His relationship with him and him coming down here to speak and commune and interact with the family. Mm-hmm. And two, him writing one or two speeches here in Bimini, right? That made it a significant action, right? Not him visiting, but the idea that he sat here and penned a famous speech. The idea that we have a picture without a narrative, without having that narrative of him writing the speech and the narrative of him having assisted in our labor movement by even giving pointers and ideas of what can be done and suggestions, right? It tells us that we didn't do our due diligence and that we need to do more moving forward in terms of promoting the Bahamas, promoting our national figures. Because Sir Randall Fox is a national significant figure, right? Mm-hmm. And we trying to equate him with a Martin Luther King.
With a Martin Luther King.
Right? And especially knowing that there are a number of civil rights leaders who came down from the United States and came here to glean some inspiration to go back to the United States to wage that war and continue that fight. Mm-hmm. See, that is significant. And I echo your sentiment.
Yeah, that we missed an opportunity. And that if we were going to go through all that headache to go and pilfer the picture and replicate the picture.
Borrowed it again.
If you replicated an artistic expression without consulting the artist, you stole it. It's as simple as that.
But it seems like a number of Bahamians do not care.
That's the point.
That's the nature of us. We just don't care.
We copycat very well. So we Jamal could draw. Let him draw it.
Yes.
As long as we don't get sued, no one cares. Mm-hmm. But there will possibly come a time if we continue with this. Mm-hmm. We've been down this road before.
Yes.
With the dollar bill.
And I believe the person
who
called.
And we get sued that time.
I believe the person who called maybe too young to even know that. That the picture of Sir Lyndon caused a controversy, and where the photographer sued the government,
right, and won.
I think got $1 million plus, you know, for the government deciding to use a picture.
And we are going right back down this road or this rabbit hole again. And then you want to talk hogwash about, you know what? I'm not even. Let me read the letter from Martin Luther King, right? And it says Martin Luther King Jr., Dexter Avenue Baptist Church, 454 Dexter Avenue, Montgomery, Alabama. August the 3rd, what does it say? That doesn't say August. That says December 15, 19... I got to get my glasses, CA. December 15, 1958. Dear Mr. Fox, this is just a note to acknowledge receipt of your very kind letter. I, too, was greatly helped by my visit to Nassau. I will long remember the expressions of genuine goodwill and moral support on the part of the people of your community. Please allow me to again express my personal appreciation to you for your determined courage and dedication to the cause of freedom and human dignity. I am sure that your name will long live in the annals of your nation's history for your willingness to suffer and sacrifice for a cause that you know is right. I hope I will have an opportunity to visit Nassau again in the not-too-distant future. Please extend my best wishes to all of the kind people that I met there. Very sincerely yours, Martin L. King, Jr. And that was addressed to Mr. Randall Fox, President of the Bahamas Federation of Labor, P.O. Box, 451 Wolf Road, New Providence, Bahamas. I mean, just think about the gravitas of that letter.
That has value.
Yeah, of course it does.
You know?
Of course it does. And no one thought we should attach that letter. Mm. No one thought we should attach the book that the letter is in. Mm. And somehow we don't see the loss there. Let me read a couple of these text messages. They say there's sentimental value to the picture. Sentimental value only matters to the person with the sentiment. It doesn't matter to anybody else. That's why your wife is important to you. Mm. Yeah? The reason I don't pay the light bill in your house is because I don't care about your wife nor your children. The reason I pay it over by me is because I ain't got no wife and I love my children. Mm. You follow?
I follow.
Perfect. This one here says, artistic drawing. What is this? Why not a photo of Martin Luther King writing his I Have a Dream speech on the beaches of Bimini? Artistic drawing, I mean. I don't know.
I see what they're trying to do. Trying to humor him. Saying, why did they select that particular picture, one with Randall Fox, mm-hmm. instead of him, an interpretive picture of Martin Luther King drawing writing the speech?
Yeah, it says to be drawing it.
So the idea is that didn't have any value. Yeah. So definitely, how is this one more? Anyway,
great show as usual, you and your guests. What does it say? Great show as usual. Question for you and your guests. How come people who you work for think you could cuss at your... What? But when you tell them... Okay, basically they want to know why is their boss cussing at them, and if they tell their boss, cuss they ma, that's insubordination. The general rule of thumb is anybody that curses you could get cursed. That's a general rule of thumb. Mm-hmm. Everywhere in the Caribbean and Canada that I know, you have to show two PCR tests within days, and both show negative before you are cleared to be free of COVID-19. It is WHO standard. Thank you very much. I appreciate that, text writer, because I haven't checked that stuff in a long time. To be quite honest, I am exhausted with COVID, and so I've decided to stop reading about it. Miller, sounds like you were able to offend that caller. You are indeed doing the Lord's work in Christ-like fashion. Trek on, my brother. Yeah. You know, today is a good breezy day. They could also go fly a kite. Mr. Miller, the quote is, if the lion does not tell his story, the hunter will take all the credit. It's the quote from former Prime Minister Christie. I think that is a Christie quote.
But Christie created that quote.
Man, I feel like Christie could have created
it. It is typical to the Bahamas, right? We always taking people things.
Yeah. And do you know something? You are very correct, right? Because I always look at our national leaders, right? Our national leaders go to great lengths to always quote former presidents, former prime ministers, right? And I think to myself, do you think he knows he's the prime minister? Mm-hmm. Like, literally, you could just make your own quote.
Yeah.
You think when JFK said, ask not what your country can do for you, but instead ask what you could... He didn't know that was going to be, you know...
Well, copying is easier. Like with the texter.
You have national office, just make your own quote. Mm-hmm. This one here says, Leyvon, a question. Leyvon, we are being invited because we have a Minister of Foreign Affairs that knows what he is doing. That office is about networking. Henfield was lost. I partially share that position. I think Mr. Henfield, although very well degreed, just wasn't as affable and as known as Fred Mitchell is. And so you will see more coming out of the office of the Foreign Affairs Minister under Fred Mitchell's reign. Mm. But the question is, Fred Mitchell will die one day. What is the backup plan? Mm. All right. Question... Leyvon, a question you have to ask was that an official visit by a prime minister? Let's move on. I guess. But, I mean, if you're saying that one of the reasons he wanted to go was because the president of the United States of America was there, then I hope he there as my prime minister and not as Lil Brave. No, I'm serious. Like, I hope that if the reason he went was because the president... Like, I want him there talking about his time in law school. Mm-hmm. I hope he is there... lobbying on behalf of the people of the Bahamas.
Or rather than be on vacation, just spend some time with
this is a field trip?
Yeah.
No, I don't know. Anyway, Sia, we're out of time. Thank you for coming.
Yeah, man.
Sia, you're always good company. You're always good to talk. Do you have something you want to say to the caller?
No. I only can smile. One can only smile. But the good thing about it is there are a number of tours about Martin Luther King happening right now. Mm-hmm. There's one being orchestrated over the hill. And I think that even Valentino Scrooge Brown is working on that. So I'm excited about that. Okay. There are two statues, at least a bust and a statue of Martin Luther King in Grand Bahama.
Yeah.
So that's something to celebrate and tout our horn over. Mm-hmm. And we need more international significant figures who came to the Bahamas. That story
we
to be told.
Tie some value to
tie some value to that.
Appreciate that, C.A. Nuri. Anyway, it's Friday. You know, I say it like I say every Friday. Do everything in your power to make sure you don't kill nobody this Friday. Greater than that, make sure with all your might that nobody don't kill you. And if you do that, I'll see you right back here on Monday. I'm Leyvon Miller. It's Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, your station for fresh news and smart talk. Don't move. News happens now.
Enough. One son died, his spirit is revisited us. True and living, living in us. Resistance is us. That's why I wrote.